be leading the service up front. Bill's going to be in back doing the technical work for a bit. Good morning. We welcome you to worship. Beautiful day. The theme for our worship is Everyone is Beautiful, and I had to smile when I came to church because we have these feathery creatures who most of us don't think is beautiful. Vultures, the turkey vultures. When I came, there were six, and they all turned around and looked at me. And then I came on in, and then I went out a little later because they told me more have arrived. And so while we gather for worship indoors, our feathery friends, remembering everyone is beautiful, are gathering above us and on the cross and on the steeple. Maybe you saw them as you came in. A couple of other announcements of more, I guess, significant note. First, a note on the fireside room. Now that we have completed a number of exterior or utility improvements to the church, from electrical systems to air conditioning and heating to a new roof that does not leak, we are beginning some interior work. It has started in a very small, simple way, made possible through memorial gifts, new shades in the fireside room. When you're in the fellowship hall, you'll be looking into the fireside room and seeing, not the fireside room, I want to say something about that in a moment, garden room, new shades in the garden room. And when you're in the fellowship hall, be sure to check it out. You'll be able to just stand there and look right through the shades. They are now somewhat translucent to allow you to see the beauty of the garden as well. We hope you'll enjoy the beauty of the garden as by going into it and experiencing it. The fireside room is next on our list. Over the next couple of months, it'll have a complete facelift. We have some wonderful old, very old, right? furniture in the fireside room. Some of that may be useful to folks. If you would like a piece of that furniture or some of that furniture, check it out. First come, first serve. Everything is available except the wall hangings and the grandfather clock. But everything else will be dispersed. So if that is of use to you, check it out. Give the church office a call. First come, first serve. Tanya Falk. Tanya, hold up your hand so folks. Tanya is Keisha's sister. She is here to share with us how Keisha is doing. You may remember last fall, Keisha was in a very serious automobile accident, life-threatening. Beautiful pictures are out there on the table with a love offering basket. Tanya's going to give us an update. I think Keisha is going to try to be here for the second service, probably, if she doesn't come soon. Keisha's unable to speak in a big way for public settings. Her voice is still rehabbing. So Tanya's going to do the good work of letting us know how it's going. Your love offering will help defray the many medical expenses that the family has experienced. If you didn't bring money with you today, take the envelope home. You can mail it to the church. We'll be gathering the love offering for the next few weeks. Now let us turn our attention to the ritual of confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, full of compassion and mercy, abounding in steadfast love. Amen. Trusting God's promise of forgiveness, let us confess our sin against God and one another. You may kneel. Eternal God, our Creator, in you we live and move and have our being. Look upon us, your children, the work of your hands. Forgive us all our offenses and cleanse us from proud thoughts and empty desires. By your grace, draw us near to you, our refuge and our strength. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit given to us. In the mercy of Almighty God, Christ died for us while we were still sinners. And for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. Amen. Please stand. God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you made us in your own image and redeemed us through Jesus, your Son. Look with compassion on the whole human family. Take away the arrogance and pride that infect our heart. Break down the walls that separate us. Unite us in bonds of love. And through our struggle to become more fully your people, help us to see your face in the faces of all people throughout the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And let us pray for the call committee and its support teams. We are in the process of preparing for the interviews. Gracious God, we give thanks for those who have been appointed to serve on the call committee and its support teams. They are entrusted with the work of discerning a new faith formation director for our congregation. As they prepare for interviews this month, grant to them wisdom, patience, and the direction of your Holy Spirit, that they may exercise right judgment and so serve you and the mission of your people here. Amen. You may be seated. I have our temple talk at this time. Could you extinguish the lights? Because we might be using screen. Now welcome Tanya Falk forward. Thank you, Tanya.
Hi, my name is Tanya Falk. For those of you that don't know me and my family, we've been members here since my parents were married in this church in 1978.
I'm going to do a little bit correction here. We forgot about you being in the pulpit with slides, so why don't you stand on this side?
Okay.
And that will work just as well. Will that be okay?
Yeah, that's fine. All four of us kids were baptized here, went to Sunday school here, and became members here over the years. My parents taught Sunday school for 10 years. We sang in the choir, and over the years, we have volunteered for many different events and projects. As the family has grown and spread out from Grand Island, we don't get to come as often as we used to. But to us, this is home, and come whenever we get the chance. I'm here today to talk about my sister, Keisha Falk. Keisha graduated from the University of Nebraska at Kearney in May of 2016. She's a daughter, sister, aunt, cousin, and friend. She's very loving, passionate, caring, kind, fun, sassy, and faithful kind of person. She has always been an active person, enjoying anything from concerts to camping, dancing, singing, gatherings with friends, time with friends and family, and of course, we can't forget the Husker football games. In September of 2016, she started her degree job as a news producer for Channel 8 in Lincoln. We were all excited and proud of where her life is going. On the way to work, January 18th, everything would change. She was involved in a life-threatening car accident. You know, you say you never forget where you were when traumatic things happen. Well, they're right. I was at work driving my forklift and rolled up on a phone to answer a page from an outside number. Your heart stops, your adrenaline kicks in, you hang up and run to tell someone I'm leaving right now. From there, it was all kind of fast and we were off to Lincoln. While we were hurrying to get there, they began emergency brain surgery. She suffered a severe head trauma from bleeding in the brain, swelling, and pressure. As we drove, the nurses would call Mom with updates since we had a long drive to get there. We began calling others and spreading the word and to get everyone we knew to start praying for. When we got there, the doctors and nurses informed us of how bad the injuries were she suffered. They had to remove a piece of her skull in order to relieve the pressure and allow her brain to swell from the injury. She had a broken arm, broken neck, two broken ribs, and fractures in the middle of her back around the shoulder blades. She was put in a medically induced coma for 10 days, and because of all the high-dose medication, she wasn't able to breathe on her own, so they had to put her on a breathing machine. Eventually, they had a trachea tube put in to continue to assist her to breathe. Doctors told us that they didn't think she would survive. Nurses told us basically don't get your hopes up too much because they didn't think she would live either. And when we met the police officer that was called to the scene, he told us he only gets called out to the fatality accidents. It didn't matter what the folks told us. We stayed strong, continued to pray for a miracle. We also believe that she was too sassy and strong to give up without a fight. At one point, my Aunt Irma made a comment and said, I think that we have every religion praying for her. Methodists, Catholics, Lutherans, Baptists, E-Free. So many prayer circles, we lost count. For Jesus said in Matthew 18, verses 19 and 20, again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. Several days, the doctors and nurses were seeing positive signs, and they couldn't even begin to explain it. All they told us was that whatever we were doing, just keep doing it because it was working. So we did. More and more people praying, and Keisha continued to improve. Since the accident, Keisha has undergone 3 surgeries, a long stay in the Madonna Rehabilitation Hospital, and she continues to do hours of outpatient rehab therapies. And even then, she may have to undergo more surgeries down the road, but she continues to improve every day. In June, she was finally able to return to work full time. Her job was very understanding during this difficult time. We have received an outpouring of support from family and friends over the past month. There have been many fundraisers going on to support her incoming medical bills. There are many different ways you can help by praying. There are also t-shirts, tanks, hoodies, bracelets, and discount cards you can purchase. The church will be accepting donations, and there's also a GoFundMe page set up online. There's more information out at the Welcome Center if you'd like to know more. We thank God every day for our walking miracle. In Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. The power of prayer, strengthened by faith, proved stronger than what doctors and medicine believed was possible. Thank you.
Again, we welcome your love offerings, not only today, but throughout this month. Let us pray. Gracious God, you are the God of miracles, and we thank you for delivering Keisha, not only from the horror of that accident, but from the challenges of her recovery. And we stand amazed with you at her beauty and her smile and her attitude that has brought her safely thus far toward a full recovery. We thank you for the caring hands of medical teams. We thank you for a loving family that stood by her and from the many friends. Lord, we continue to pray for her good health, and we thank you for the opportunity to be a part of her journey. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And thank you to a sister who was brave to speak. I didn't see you come in, Keisha. Did people see you yet? If not, stand so just we can give you applause again. Thank you for being here. We continue now with the reading of scriptures.
First lesson is a reading from the first letter of John. Beloved, let us love one another because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. It is in this love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we ought to also love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 15th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing, but I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. I'm going to do an introduction. Bill's serving as our tech person back now on some of the things. And when we get to the video, I'll tell you when to play it. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. During the summer, we're using some videos as sermon starters. In the videos, you get to meet some of the great spiritual minds of our day as they share their wisdom and insight with us. Today it is my privilege to introduce to you Jean Vanier. Jean Vanier, many of you probably have never heard of him, but I would put him in the same circle as Mother Teresa. And that's not an exaggeration. Jean Vanier is a man of great spiritual wisdom, as Mother Teresa was, and he is a great Christian humanitarian. I'll share some of that story with you. In my own ministry, probably two people stand like giants, particularly in these last 10 or 15 years of my ministry. I'm forever indebted to them. Because of their wisdom and insight. One of those is Richard Rohr, Father Richard Rohr. We met him a few weeks ago in a video. We'll meet him again in one of the upcoming videos. The other is Jean Vanier, particularly for his wonderful wisdom and insights with the Gospel of John. Jean Vanier, when you see him, he's going to be in his mid-80s, probably doing this interview. He will be celebrating his 89th birthday in September. He is Canadian by birth, French-Canadian, Roman Catholic heritage. His mom and dad were very active in governmental circles at the Canadian level and in international levels as well. His mother, a great humanitarian in her own right. At the age of 13, he joined the Royal Navy, imagine that, and was on his way through academic training to become an officer. They were in France when World War II broke out, and they took refuge in England. At the age of 17, right after World War II concluded, Jean left his classes in England and had to stay with his mother in Paris. At that time, she was ministering to the death camp survivors, the Holocaust survivors. And as a 17-year-old, he joined her. You can imagine the impact that had on him as he looked into those faces of such horror-stricken people. When he went back to England, he resigned his commission in the Royal Navy, began searching for a deeper truth, got his doctorate in philosophy, became a great writer in philosophy and theology, great teacher in academic circles. And then in 1964, at the age of 36, something again stirring in his soul. And he stepped out of the academic world. In France, Father Thomas Philip took him under wing, became a spiritual friend and mentor to him. And through Father Thomas, Jean was finally exposed to a reality that was kind of shoved aside by the world. And that was that there were thousands and thousands of people who were deemed not beautiful, not needed for society, to be warehoused in institutions. They had what we would call mental disability. Even that word is kind of problematic. And these were people who were just pushed away, kept behind walls. That's how it was done in the civilized world. And where do you start when there are thousands and thousands of such people? Well, he started with two. He welcomed two of the residents of one of those institutions into his own home. They became family, Raphael and Philip. They were like brothers to him, and that's where it started. L'Arche communities. The L'Arche communities are now throughout the world, 37 different nations, but it started right there in Jean Vanier's home. And these communities are set up so that the residents are no longer behind walls, but live with their people who care for them and help them with some of their needs. Not only in 37 communities, but I would say many other organizations like Mosaic, have modeled their own programs after L'Arche communities. Jean Vanier has done many other humanitarian enterprises in his life, has received numerous international awards, among them the Templeton Award. That is the equivalent of the Nobel Peace Prize in Christian circles. We will meet Jean Vanier in his mid-80s. He is being asked, you have practiced a life of love. You have taught that reaching out to those whom we deem less worthy, that when we welcome them into our homes, they become the face of Jesus to us, and they become our teachers, not burdens for us to care for, but they become our teachers. They are the face of Jesus to us, and they teach us to become the face of Jesus for others. So then comes a question, and the question is, how are you dealing with a part of the church that has been severely criticizing you for being a humanist? That's kind of a label that the fundamentalist church put on him. A humanist as though you're not a fully fledged follower of Christ. And he will speak to that question. And as he speaks to that question, we will be led into understanding this mystery of Jesus who is love and calls us to be the face of love for others. So, Bill, can we show that video? And do we need sound? There is a switch yet to set.
Reinforcements have arrived. We'll fix this shortly. What's the verdict, Bill? I see a puzzled look. Are we able to have sound or not? No sound? Is that the verdict? Okay, I'm going to stop my sermon here. I know it's a disappointment, but my sermon is based on the video. So we'll save this for another Sunday. And we will continue with the sermon hymn that follows sermon. Please stand.
Yeah. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. What does this mean? I believe that God has created me together with all that exists. God has given me and still preserves my body and soul, eyes, ears, and all limbs and senses, reason and all mental faculties. In addition, God daily and abundantly provides shoes and clothing, food and drink, house and farm, spouse and children, fields, livestock, and all property, along with all the necessities and nourishment for this body and life. God protects me against all danger and shields and preserves me from all evil. And all this is done out of pure, fatherly, and divine goodness and mercy, without any merit or worthiness at all. For all of this, I owe it to God to thank and praise, serve and obey. This is most certainly true. Called together in the Spirit's embrace, we pray for the mending of God's world. Humble God, lead your church in the way of service. Prosper the work of campus ministries, young adults in global mission, as they raise up leaders to serve the world. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Cultivating and generous God, bless and encourage all who work the land to feed your people. Sustain them and grant them joy in their vocation. Provide favorable weather for the crops, for health of livestock. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Holy One, you command peace among the nations. We pray for leaders gathering in summit, in conversation, to face global problems with wise, generous, and compassionate solutions. Give peaceful hearts and discerning minds to those leaders. And we pray that all who suffer violence and hunger might come to know the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Gracious God, you bid the weary come to you for rest. Renew energy for those who are tired and weary. Support all of our brothers and sisters who are burdened by grief, by loneliness, by illness. Lord, in your mercy. God of all of life, you have compassion for all that you have made. Show our congregation and guide our congregation to be examples of what mercy looks like in our own community. Help us grow as faithful partners in this ministry. Lord, in your mercy. All of these things and all else you see that we need, we entrust to your care through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Take a moment to share the peace of Christ with those around us.
Peace be with you.
Would you move the TV? Probably. Please stand. We pray together the offering prayer. Merciful God, you open wide your hand and satisfy the need of every living thing. You have set this feast before us. Open our hands to receive it. Open our hearts to embrace it. Open our lives to live it. We pray this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We give them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." The same way he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Let us join hands as we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Come, let us eat, for now the feast is spread. Our Lord's body, let us take together.
body of Christ given for you. Blood of Christ shed for you.
Blood of Christ shed for you.
Thank you. May this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen.
Together we pray. Jesus Christ, host of this meal, you have given us not only this bread and cup, but your very self, that we may feast on your great love. Filled again by these signs of your grace, may we hunger for your reign of justice. May we thirst for your way of peace, for you are Lord forevermore. Amen. May God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine, grant you the gifts of faith and hope. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.